For more on the bull rally, we're going to turn to a Squawk market master, PIMCO's Bond King. Joining us now, Bill Gross, PIMCO founder, co-chief investment officer, and managing director. Hi, Bill.
Hi, Michelle.
People seem to be universally bullish on the stock market. Nouriel Roubini even the other day. I mean, we can't find a bear among the group. I know you're the bond guy, but if they're right about stocks, that means that money presumably comes out of bonds, right? And definitely affects you. What are you thinking here?
Well, it can. We're sort of a bull on the stock market as well, Michelle.
Oh, my gosh.
Not a two-eared and one-tailed bull like in Spain, but perhaps a one-ear in terms of an award. We think the market can go up 5 to 6%, and we know it's done that already in the month of January. But, you know, that's a decent return and a bullish statement, I think, going forward. But, you know, what we've observed, Michelle, is not that the money is coming out of the bond market. PIMCO actually got $20 billion in January inflows as opposed to outflows, and we're not seeing outflows in the total return fund. We're seeing inflows. We think it's come from money market funds. We think it's come from capital gains and delayed dividend payments from last year, et cetera, but not from the bond market at the moment.
Is the bond bubble breaking right now? When we talk about the 10-year yield at 2%, when we saw the sharp rise over the last couple of weeks, albeit off low levels, is this the beginning of what we're now calling the Great Rotation?
Well, I think going back to last July in 2012, you know, we saw the beginnings of a bear market in long bonds. You mentioned the 10-year. You know, the 30-year bottomed at 2.5%. It's now around 3.20. That's 70 basis points. That's about a 15% decline in terms of the long bond. And what we've suggested over that entire period of time is don't own long bonds. It's really the same thing as when observers talk about the stock market being a market of stocks. The bond market is a market of bonds. And if you can avoid long-term bonds, if you can buy tips, if you can buy something from Mexico, Brazil, Italy, Spain with higher yields and more defensive protection relative to price, then I think you've got a chance to earn 3 to 4% in the bond market.
Bill, this is this is Rich Bernstein. There has been an absolute flood of individual investor money and even institutional money into short duration bond funds. ISI, who I'm sure you know, has a bond manager survey. It shows that bond portfolio managers are habitually short duration versus benchmark. Everybody is scared that rates are going up. Is there a risk in taking positions in short duration bonds now with this huge flood into those kind of products?
Well, it's an opportunity risk. You know, the shorter the duration, the lower the yield, you do get defensive protection, and that's the reason why they're going into it. To a certain extent, you know, PIMCO is shading their durations a little bit to the lower side, but basically close to index. So, you know, a low duration vehicle, it is really a bet that interest rates go up, and because of that, you earn 1 to 2% as opposed to 3 to 4%, and I think that's the greatest risk.
Bill, I want to go back to equities just for one second. You somewhat famously over the summer, back in August, wrote the cult of equity is dying. You had a great tweet, if I remember. You said, boomers can't take a risk. Gen X and Gen Y believe in Facebook but not its stock, and Gen Z has no money. Have you changed your view?
No, I think that's true, and we can speak to January and the Great Rotation, but that's a one-month type of thing. Typically, money comes in January and in lots of markets. And so the cult of equity was really not a downer in terms of returns, but it was a downer in terms of the willingness and the ability of demographic influences and forces to present a change to stocks. What we're seeing and what we're going to see demographically is a lot of boomers getting older and older. And frankly, boomers like certainty. They like stability. They like a fixed income type of return. And that's not PIMCO's
And you don't think
definition.
That if the equity market continues, at, maybe not at this pace, but continues going up, that at some point they say, you know what, I missed this train, I got to get on it?
Yeah, I think they will at the margin, but let's face it, they've been burned 2, 3, 4 times in the last decade. They've been burned by the dot-coms. They've been burned by Lehman. They've been burned. They saw their 401ks become 201ks, and there's a certain defensiveness that's been built into investors, and I think at the margin some of them will come back. They should come back. We're recommending
Bill,
that stocks go up by 6%, but not to the extent that we saw 5 or 10 years ago.
Bill, I just want to be clear about what you're saying, because this latest piece I read of yours is full of all these apocalyptic terms, you know, like Death Star and supernova and $56 trillion of leverage, and it takes $10 of of debt to raise a dollar of GDP these days. It sounds like you are very pessimistic and expecting really bad outcomes here from reading that piece. Is that your take on the world?
Well, not Death Star. Death Star's not in there, Steve, but,
Nova, something like that. And that's all I heard. I heard Death Star, you know? I mean,
that's
I'm thinking
new.
Of you as Darth Vader, Bill.
No,
I mean,
no, it was a metaphor, and I explained it in that way and said this was a metaphor for a supernova expansion of credit. You know, we've gone from $3 trillion worth of credit in the 70s to $56 trillion right. worth of credit today. And that's a huge expansion. That's like a supernova explosion. What a supernova does, though, is it explodes and then it contracts and consumes itself at the margin over time.
Right. So I missed the apocalyptic stuff in there, I guess, is what you're saying. No, really. I mean, what are you saying is going to happen here because of this $56 trillion of debt, and when does it happen?
Well, I think that credit from this point forward, and actually for the last 5 years, the influence of credit is less and less potent. It's anemic relative to what it was. Like I did state, you know, it takes $20 of credit now to generate $1 of real GDP, whereas back in the 70s it took $5. And so the more and more credit is required to expand the economy. It's the same thing as asking, can you solve a debt crisis? Can you solve a credit crisis with more debt?
Right, but I want to know, Bill, what is the outcome from this? What are you saying is going to happen as a result of the exploding supernova and the contraction?
Well, here's what happens at the margin. At the margin, you know, this credit expansion, which is produced by low interest rates, near zero interest rates, you know, has an effect on financial companies and financial business models, which in turn has an effect on the real economy in terms of employment and layoffs. Banks, for instance, just one good example, their net interest margins narrow, therefore they can't create more branches, they lay off people, investment banks the same way, insurance companies, any company that makes money with money, you know, is threatened at the margin.
Bill, Doug has a question for you. He's the chief economist at Fannie.
Are you still in the 2% growth for the next 10 to 20 years, Kent?
Well, we never said 10 to 20 years, but we said for the next 3 to 5 years. That's our new normal. It's come true, has it not, over the past 3 to 4 years? And we think the 2% number in the U.S., the global growth of 3.5%, 0% in Euroland, yes, is a number, you know, based upon structural headwinds such as demographics, globalization, technology, and high debt levels, all combining to limit growth relative to the past 5 to 10 years.
You're willing to buy Italy, even though it looks like Silvio Berlusconi could be running the joint again?
Well, we talk about that every day. We don't think that's going to happen, but obviously it influences yields on a daily basis. We think Italy has a good balance sheet, Michelle. Actually, it has a balance of payment surplus on a primary level relative to the United States. So it's got some things going for it.
Wow. Besides the pizza and the pasta and the food and everything else. Bill, so good to see you.
They've always had a primary surplus.
Yeah, I know. That's true. I know. They remind us of that all the time. Bill, good to see you this morning. We
Thank
really appreciate
you guys.
It.
My fun. Thank you.